Folks, if you're joining us for the first time, this is the Apologetics Academy, and the idea is we bring in different speakers each week from across the theological and philosophical spectrum to present to us on topics of interest to Christians, particularly pertaining to the question of whether Christianity is in fact true. And so we bring in Christians, we bring on atheists, we bring on Muslims and people of other worldview persuasions and perspectives, and the idea is to facilitate dialogue, discussion, and cordial debate and interaction. This week, we are going to be having a discussion about the Gospels and whether they are reliable, and we'll get into that in just a bit. The following event is with Dr. Doug Axe of the Biologic Institute in Seattle, Washington. Dr. Doug Axe is a molecular biologist, and he is going to be talking to us about his recent book, Undeniable, How Biology Confirms Our Intuition That Life is Designed. And we're actually moving his talk to the 25th of November, so there'll be no webinar next Saturday, but we'll have him on November 25th, which is a Friday. And then on the 26th of November, we are going to be talking to a Muslim apologist from South Africa, whom I have debated in the past. His name is Yusuf Ismail, and he is going to be talking to us about, does the Quran promote peace or aggressive violence? And he's going to be making the case that, in fact, the Quran promotes peace, and we'll be asking him questions as well. And then we have the following week on and the first weekend of December, we have Dr. Michael Bird on, who's a biblical scholar in Australia, and he is the author of the book How God Became Jesus, which is the response to Bar Ehrman's book How Jesus Became God, and he's going to be presenting to us on the thesis of his book, talking about early church Christology and the self-identity of Jesus and so on. Because he's in Australia, we have the differences in time zone. He's going to be starting it at 11 p.m. GMT, which is just a few hours later than we normally start, just to facilitate his time zone. So that's the next few sessions that we've got coming up. So back to this week, we have Dr. Bob Price, who is an atheist with a PhD in New Testament studies. So he's a very well-credentialed Bible scholar, and he is going to be dealing with the subject of, are the Gospels reliable? Can we trust the Gospels? And just to give you some indication as to how you can interact in this live webinar, if you are a viewer today, you can interact in a few different ways. There's a chat box, which you might have already discovered, and you can, as the webinar is going on, you can type something in the chat window. Please direct your chat to everyone rather than just panelists. You can also submit questions anonymously by hitting the Q&A button, typing in a question, and our guest speaker will do his best to respond. Or you can raise your hand. There's a raise hand button, and I will promote you to be a co-panelist with the speaker and give you the opportunity to interact and engage and go back and forth with him. So without further ado, Bob, do you want to just maybe, just for those that maybe haven't come across your work before, just tell us about who you are and what you do, and then just give us a sort of a short introduction as to your perspective and view on the Gospels.
Mm-hmm. For one thing, I just got to say, as no doubt everybody does on this this webinar series, that I think this is such a great idea, and I have such admiration for the work that goes into it. I just love dialogue like this. And I should also point out I had been kind of a apologist wannabe back in college, and I was in the InterVarsity Christian Fellowship and read everything they put out, and Josh McDowell, F.F. Bruce, you name it, and was really tickled with the whole idea of being able to defend the faith in a historical way that would, as I think, did C.S. Lewis say this, or John Warwick Montgomery say this about him? I figured, well, it'd be great if we could drag people kicking and screaming into the kingdom. The more I got into this, the more I began to think my position just was not viable, that I had always been told one side of the story, and there were many other factors that no one had ever told me about, and so I became disappointed with it, to the point where I felt myself at a crossroads, that I could either continue on my way into evangelicalism and some sort of ministry in it. Or I could be honest with myself and the Bible, because I just didn't think I could continue on with the prescribed way of interpreting it. Now, in all of this, I am just sharing my perspective. I do not care to convince people of it. And as you mentioned, I'm an atheist, or at least not a theist. And I really do not like to identify with the atheist movement. There's all sorts of things in it I don't care for. But my goal is never to change anybody's mind, whether to or from belief or one religion or the lack of religion. My goal is just a Socratic one. I like to supply perspectives and information that perhaps my listeners or readers are not familiar with, and just so they can make of it what they will. I had to come up with my own provisional changing synthesis. I figure all intellectually curious people are doing that, and if I can be a resource, then it's none of my business what people do with it or where they come out. I have no axe to grind in that sense. So that's my approach. Atheist, believer, whatever, it's all fine with me. Though there is a little bit of a shock value in being an atheist New Testament scholar, I thought I could really get the eyebrows raised if I were to at some point bill myself as a Satanist New Testament scholar. Now that would be a riot. That would really be a Zen slap waking people up. But of course, I don't believe in that either, so I can't do it. But I want to let the opinions speak for themselves. So why do I consider the Gospels unreliable historically? Well, that is I'd rather put it another way, that I've changed my perspective on what I think the Gospels are. When I see them as not historically reliable, it's just that I think there has been a category mistake, and that people are asking the wrong questions of the Gospels. It's the old hermeneutical circle thing, like Bultmann says. You come to the Bible with certain legitimate questions, but you may find that it doesn't have the kind of answers you want. You may have to go back to the drawing board and find more appropriate questions, and then back and forth again. And that's been my experience. So I tend to think that the Gospels are basically deposits of legend, of theological fiction, of edifying tales, and so on, and that there may be historical bits and pieces, but the longer I've been at this, the less I think that is so. And let me just tell you very briefly, I hope, why that is. Again, what strikes me, the kind of thing that got me out of the apologetic approach, and do with it what you will, right? For one thing, there are numerous contradictions in the Gospels. You can call them apparent contradictions if you want, but it's hard to get past apparent, so it's almost a redundancy. The birth narratives notoriously contradict one another to the point where it's really impossible to harmonize them. Matthew and Luke have so little in common except the fact, well, we think it's a fact that they present a virginal conception, though even that's disputable. The idea of where did Mary and Joseph live, and did they live in Nazareth and went to Bethlehem because of the tax census in Luke, and then later returned to Nazareth, or as per Matthew, did they live in Bethlehem, then went to Egypt, and then came back to Nazareth, and so on and so on. There's very little in agreement there. The genealogies, that's just, there's just no way. They seem to contradict the nativity stories in the context of which we find them, but they don't agree with one another, and it gets pretty desperate if you start saying, well, one of them was really Mary's genealogy. It's just an expedient of desperation. On the other end of the story, there are the resurrection narratives, which have not only serious contradictions between them, but also seem to contradict what most consider, I'm not sure I do, but what most consider to be an earlier text, 1 Corinthians 15. Was Jesus raised in a body of flesh and bones as in Luke, or did he become a life-giving spirit as in 1 Corinthians 15, who had to, because flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of God? The issues of how many men or angels went to the tomb, what did the women see? These things are often brushed off as matters of minor detail, though I think that is not the case. If you had witnesses in court that couldn't even agree on whether they had seen Jesus, you really would have cause for serious doubt. In terms of teaching, did Jesus recommend fasting or abstain from it? Did he teach the disciples no longer to fast because the kingdom had come, or not to fast yet, but there would soon come a time when they would go back to it? Or did he say, yes, fast, just don't be like the hypocrites, etc.? I don't think that's easily reconcilable. The confession of Peter. What on earth did Peter say? You are the Christ. You are the Christ of God. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. You're the Holy One of God. Or as in Thomas, Master, my mouth is not able to say what you are like. It seems to me, if you have that kind of evolution and embellishment, you can just forget about knowing what he may have said. Speaking of Pete, another one of these problems is, did Peter walk on the water? I guess if Jesus could, Peter could, but the problem is, why do Mark and John have only the walking on water by Jesus and not Peter if he actually did it? Did they just run out of ink? Did they think it not worth mentioning? Well, we've already got one guy walking on the water. It just seems implausible to me, and there are numerous others. There are anachronisms, one of the most famous, of course, being the census of Quirinius, the attempts of William Ramsay and others to try to pull a rabbit out of a hat on this one just no longer convinced me. And again, I remind you, these are the disappointed conclusions I came to from within the evangelical apologetic frame of mind. This is the kind of thing that disappointed me. I'm not trying to attack the Gospels from a point of hostility. I still love the Gospels. There are sayings that seem anachronistic. Jesus is talking to a crowd of people that must not have had any theological or Christological opinions yet, and yet he says, whoever would be my disciple, let him take up his cross and follow me. Now, there have been attempts to whittle that down, but certainly it seems to imply that Jesus is talking over the heads of the characters to the reader, who is a Christian, who already knows Jesus went to the cross. So great, great saying, very profound and radical, very noble, but it seems to me not likely historical. The synagogue ban in John, is it a matter for the future, as Jesus says in the Last Supper discourse, or has it already happened, as in chapter 9 with the man born blind? Mark 7 with the kosher laws, Mark's note to the reader about the kosher practices of Jews in Palestine seems incorrect. He's describing diaspora Jewish practices that were only necessary because they didn't live in the Holy Land in a Jewish society. Not only that, the linchpin of the whole passage is a quote from the Septuagint version of Isaiah, something unlikely to be invoked in a debate between Jesus and Palestinian Pharisees, but highly relevant to Mark's Greek-speaking readers. And again, there are others. How about materials that are distinctive and unique to single gospels? Something I would not expect if you had random or spontaneous collections of Jesus traditions. The screaming example of this is the Johannine discourses. They're so massive in John and yet virtually unhinted of in the Synoptic Gospels, whereas they sound an awful lot like, at least the terminology, of the Johannine epistles. Well, what do we make of that? It seems to me, and to many scholars, that probably it's somebody's rewriting and someone using Jesus as a kind of a mouthpiece for deeper truths since revealed by the Paraclete. The parables in the Gospel of Luke, the ones unique to Luke, seem to be his own work. As far as I can tell, they have a real narrative structure. It's not like just the sower in the field, scattering the seed. You've got characters and internal monologue and deliberation on the same pattern, because several of them involve a character reaching a crisis and saying, what shall I do? Oh, I will so-and-so. Again and again, it just seems to me, even the Jesus seminar colleagues of mine who say, oh yeah, this is real Jesus stuff, let's color it red. I just don't see how they can ignore that. It's distinctively Lucan. Why is Matthew the only one concerned with matters of rabbinical nicety? What kind of oath can you swear? By the gold of the temple, by the altar, etc., etc.? And it just seems to me that this represents a conflict between a Jewish community late in the first century and the emergent so-called normative Judaism of Yavne, as does, for instance, the famous two-donkey approach to Jerusalem. Did this really happen? And the others just figured, well, they'd save a little ink and mention one donkey. Well, of course not. But it fits in perfectly with rabbinic exegesis of the Old Testament, which did not pay heed to synthetic parallelism in the Psalms. You know, you say it one way and then in another way, and it backs it up nicely, very effective. They knew how that poetry worked and even wrote new poems on that model themselves, but when it came to the scripture, they treated it as if it were all flat prose just to eke out more information from them. Well, that's just what is happening there. The unique church order material in Matthew is highly reminiscent of the Dead Sea Scrolls. You insult your brother and you're liable to the council. What council? You're not going to be taking somebody to the National Sanhedrin for saying, you know, Raqqa, and so on. The idea of shunning somebody that has offended you and treating them like a Gentile or a tax collector, boy, that doesn't really fit in with Mark's picture of Jesus, right? He loved the old tax collectors and sinners and so forth. There are parallels to pagan and rabbinical materials aplenty. When Jesus says something that is said in nearly the same words throughout rabbinic literature, it's like a case of what Jacob Neusner calls the unattached or peripatetic, the wandering saying that appears often in the Mishnah attributed to this and that different rabbi. It's hard to know who originally said it. People like to claim a famous saying for this one or that one, so Jesus might have said it, but it really puts the question mark beside everything. The miracle stories, many of them parallel in startling outline, miracles attributed to Apollonius of Tyana, Pythagoras, Hanina ben Dosa, and especially Elijah, Elisha, and Moses. And you have to ask yourself, why accept the biblical ones without much qualm, but just reject the others as pagan fantasies? It's not really a question of dependence. Was it borrowed from one by the other? It's just, you've got several of these. Isn't it special pleading to say, well, the biblical ones have to be assumed to be true? You'd have to have a pretty good reason to discount them. But the other ones, well, that's just a lot of nonsense. But to me, it ultimately boils down to the question of historical apologetics versus historical method. How do you deal with all the things I have pointed out here that so troubled me? Do you deal with them inductively or deductively? If you start with the view that if I can come up with some ad hoc hypothesis to harmonize these contradictions, et cetera, whatever would seem to do it. Well, that's good enough. We can go right on believing what we were taught in church. As Donald Guthrie and I. Howard Marshall and F.F. Bruce and typically apologists will say, well, if the critic, if Bultmann or Marxson or whoever cannot absolutely disprove the traditional view, then we're entitled to go right on blithely asserting that it is true. No, you can't. In a matter of dispute, you can't say if one decision is possible, much less plausible, then that's the way to go. Anybody that does that somehow seems not to see what they're doing, that they're doing apologetics. They're already committed to the position, in this case, on the accuracy of the Gospels, and they're trying to see how they can make it look best. It's like a defense attorney or a political spin doctor. Okay, any answer that doesn't comport with our agenda is the wrong answer. Anyone that does is the right answer. That's not historical method, because all historians, if they know what they're doing, I think most of them do, will say that all historical theories are just that. They're hypotheses. They're tentative. They're provisional. They're constantly open to revision. And as a result, they must not be held dogmatically. That seems to me to make possible at most a position that says, well, as near as we can tell, this and that and the Gospels appear to be right. But you know as well as I do that people who are engaged in apologetics are rooting for one side. They're rooting for it to be true. And so and the paradigm carries its own criterion of plausibility. It's going to sound good to me if it will get me out of a tight spot and if it comports with what I'm already, as a Christian, supposed to believe. That's just not historical. That's like the kind of stuff that is easily recognizable when Jehovah's Witnesses or Muslims or whatever. Whenever anybody does this, you can tell they're just spinning. And you can't do that. If I say to people, ask yourself, is this argument, does it sound good to me only because if true, it would get me out of a tight spot? If that's the case, then you better go back to the drawing board. And if you really are serious about history, and it's not just a play acting exercise, you can't have such investment in the theory, the argument coming out one way. It's like Kierkegaard said, you're bearing down too heavily on the saw. So it seems to me, I felt I had to finally at that crossroads decide that I have to go. I mean, I was always told, if it's not true, let's find out. It'd be better to know. And I was always told and agreed that the thing here is to understand what the Bible is saying and not to be bullheaded about it. So that kind of remains my guiding signal, and that's why I have arrived at the position I hold. Again, of course, I know honest minds differ. The state of affairs will look different to different people. I'm not a mind reader, and as Jeremiah says, who can know his own heart? But you have to call them like you see them, though you can't call them like a final verdict. If you're doing history, it has to be tentative. And those who are interested in dogmatism and creeds can't really allow themselves to do that. They hold, as it seems to me, a kind of schizophrenic position, which I decided I just did not want to try to hold anymore. So I guess that's enough ranting from me.
Well, thank you, Dr. Price, for that introduction. Folks, this is the interactive portion of the program. So if you would like to interact with Dr. Price, and simply click the raise hand button, that will promote you to be a co-panelist, or you can also submit questions by hitting the Q&A button as well. While we're waiting for someone to raise their hand, let me just read out some of the questions that have been submitted. We have four questions from one person, so let me read those. Toby asks, if you believe that the New Testament is unreliable, why keep studying it? Just general interest or a niggling doubt?
General interest or what? I'm sorry?
Or a niggling doubt.
I probably wouldn't be so interested in it had I not been a born-again fundamentalist earlier in my life. But I'm glad I was, I guess, because I find it so inherently, endlessly fascinating. And of course, there's an awful lot of edifying stuff in it. One gripe I have against atheists is they're very often disposed to say that the Bible might as well be Mein Kampf with a different name on it. It's absurd. There's plenty of great stuff in the Bible, and even if you no longer believe it, that it still just repays study. There's great wisdom in it. And even if there weren't, it's incredibly fascinating.
Okay. Toby also asked, Jesus said when you fast, which indicates that he thought you should and would. What are your thoughts around this? And do you think the disciples actually recorded his words or not?
I don't see much reason to think that there were eyewitness recorders of what Jesus said. There could have been, but it's just there's so many possible sources and so many ifs in the hypothesized chain of tradition. The situation seems very much to me like the hadith of Muhammad. Supposedly, they all go back to eyewitnesses of the prophet, and they can name all of them with these long chains of names. But even Islamic scholars early on realized that by far most of them had to be spurious because people were trying to promote their own pious opinions, and the only way, well, it's like the pseudonymous stuff in the Apocrypha. Did Jeremiah really write the Epistle of Jeremy? Well, somebody wanted to claim his clout to get attention for something he thought was cogent. That's what they did in a similar milieu to early Christianity and formative Islam, and it seems to me that they contradict quite a bit, and the fasting thing is a good example, because that seems to me to contradict the whole setting presupposed by the scene where the disciples of John and of the Pharisees approach Jesus and say, we fast, why don't you? It's a pious practice. And there's two mini parables sort of run together. The old wineskins and new wine seems to be telling us that, no, that's over with. Fasting was penitential expectation for the kingdom of God, which has in fact come. So why do you need it? You're not going to benefit from it if you pretend it hasn't come. Whereas the bridegroom, that everybody celebrates when he's there, but don't worry, he will leave or be taken away one day, and then it'll be time to fast. That seems to me diametrically opposite, and neither one of them fit with the Matthean Sermon on the Mount saying when you fast, which implies, I think, that he assumes his hearers and disciples, Matthew says he's speaking to his disciples, that they are fasting. Well, which is it? Now, I know it's possible to come up with a lattice of what ifs and maybe he really meant this, but the mere fact you have to do that begins to make it look less likely that, oh yeah, we have a simple recording of what he said. There's just no way to know.
Toby asks, why do you find it a problem that different people write different accounts in different ways? We do that ourselves. We can also understand what is said differently and will therefore write it out differently, but the conclusion is the same. Jesus is Lord, died, and rose again, etc. A bit like working out a maths problem, but still getting the same answer or result.
Well, you're already coming perilously close to my position on this. If there's that much latitude and there's no way to get back to which view really goes back to Jesus, you're really already in bed with Bultmann and all these guys. There's you're entering into what I think Bauer called the marshy bog of suppositions and so on. There's no way to know any longer. Like, can you imagine someone that said, well, my friends, Jesus may have taught so-and-so, so let's do that. It becomes completely iffy then. I mean, what he says could well be, but that also, that's really in the critical camp, not the biblicist camp. I hope that's not a pejorative term.
Sure. Toby asks, what reliable parts have you found in the Gospels?
I hate to tell you this, but I tend to think that none of it goes back to a historical Jesus any more than there's any reason to think that the voluminous teaching attributed to Gautama Buddha actually goes back to a historical individual. That's not a provable thing, but to me, it currently, that seems to make the most sense of it. I don't think these criteria, like the criteria of dissimilarity and multiple attestation, work at all. And in fact, they undermine the possibility that anything really goes back to Jesus. I can explain why, but I'm probably putting you to sleep already.
Toby says, did you ever meet with Jesus through reading his word, talking to his people, or just by experiencing him by his spirit directly? This will have a very strong bearing on the angle that you come at the Gospels from.
Well, of course, I started as an evangelical born-again Christian of about a dozen years who daily studied the Bible, had devotions, prayed, led others to Christ. I would have said I had a personal relationship with Christ, and I was pretty happy about it. I didn't approach this from without as a critic of Christianity, and in fact, in many ways, I'm still not a critic of Christianity. And so I had that experience, but I eventually realized any Jehovah's Witness, any Hare Krishna could say the same thing, and just subjective experience cannot determine historical assertions. It's just a whole different realm of inquiry.
Okay, we have a couple hands. Let me bring up Blake from Chicago. Hey Blake, how are you doing?
Doing good. Can you hear me all right?
You can. Go ahead.
Hey, Dr. Price. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, it's a privilege.
Yeah, it's really cool to have you here. So when it comes to the Gospels, I know a lot of contemporary New Testament scholars think it at least falls in the genre of Greco-Roman biography. Do you think they're mistaken on this, or are you okay with it and you just want to say, yeah, but the gospel authors were dishonest, or is there some other path that you're carving, or where do you fall on that?
Well, I do think that basically the genre is that of Hellenistic biography, but another shining example of that would be the life of Apollonius of Tyana, or any of the, I think, four lives of Pythagoras, Iamblichus, and the others, and it's hard to know, or the Gospels of the Buddha. It's the form does, or let's say Ibn Ishaq's Life of Muhammad, a huge work based on the Hadith, but apparently historically worthless. And I think that the genre of hagiography or biography is not really a guide to how historically sound it is. I don't think there was much in the way of deception, though I must admit there are a few places where I wrote this paper called Fraud and Imposture in the New Testament for a Society of Biblical Literature thing, and I first tried to make clear that a lot of the things in the Gospels that are supposed to be inaccurate are not deceptions, but that there is reason to take a few of them, like this is the Bible, not the Gospel, but the Second Peter, we were there on the holy mountain when the voice came. That's, I think, a pious fraud. He wasn't there and he knows it. And I suspect some of the stuff about the empty tomb and the transfiguration, well, nobody ever heard of this until now, and here's why. But on the whole, I don't think so. I think it was just a kind of myth of writing of pseudo history, much like the saints' legends of the Middle Ages, much like parables. So I think the idea that it was all a hoax is kind of silly, but that the only alternative is not that of historical accuracy.
And a lot of what they're trying to say is, some of these authors, is that there's an implicit claim by the authors that they're in contact with the eyewitnesses, with the relevant eyewitnesses that sort of get listed throughout. But you don't think that that's correct?
No, I think it's like the Hadith again. There is, as it says in Hebrews and in the prologue to Luke, as we were taught these things by those who were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word and so on. I think that's just an attempt to create credentials, much like the equally pious and Christian claims that the Apostle Andrew founded the church in Scotland and the Apostle Thomas founded the church in India. There's no reason to think that, or that Peter had founded the church in Rome. In these cases, even Protestants will say, nah, I'm sorry, this is legendary, though for pious reasons. And I think the claim for eyewitness testimony of the Gospels is the same if it were not. I mean, if it were genuine eyewitness material, it would sound a lot different. It would sound more like in the Acts of John. There's this section called the preaching of John, where the Apostle John is telling his disciples the way it was hanging around with Jesus. And he said this to me one day, he said that, table talk sort of stuff. That's in fact spurious, the stuff in the Acts of John, but at least he knew what eyewitness testimony should sound like. The gospel writers are not even trying to do that.
Okay.
And there are numerous reasons, it seems to me, to say that they're not based on eyewitnesses. Some of it might be, but this notion, I think, is fantastic, that there was this Snopes group, this bunch of people whose job it was to weed out spurious rumors like we have today online, and that nobody could get away with fabricating anything Jesus hadn't actually said. That's just, you know how the Schweitzer said the liberal theologians recast Jesus in their own image? This is evangelical apologists trying to make Jesus and the apostles into an evangelical apologist. Had they done this, it would come in quite handy for evangelical apologists, but there is simply no reason to think they did or even could have had they wanted to. And so I think it's much more like this false eyewitness claims of the isnads, the chains of supposed transmitters of the Hadith.
Okay, so cool. And then there's a ton to talk about there, because I think that's sort of the target is this really grounded at all in eyewitness testimony? And one piece of evidence that I thought was particularly interesting that I'd love to get your thoughts on, that I'm sure you've heard about, but I should probably lay it out so that other people are aware of it, is this study that Bauckham did with Jewish names, where he took a new lexicon, I guess, came out, and it basically is the culmination of all this research of people looking at inscriptions on tombs and other documents of the relevant era. And they produced a telephone book of 3,000 of these Jewish names. And it wasn't just the names. They knew specifically the people who bore them. So the idea is that Bauckham used this material to test John, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, Acts, to see if the names lined up with Palestinian names in the way that eyewitness testimony would.
The names of characters in the Gospels?
Persons, right, yes.
Uh-huh.
And so then the question is, okay, well, what names are popular and to what degree at this exact time and place? And it turns out, Bauckham concludes, that the ratios match really well with the Gospels and Acts. So, for example, what percent of men bore one of the two most popular male names, Simon and Joseph? And in the lexicon of these 3,000 names, it's 15.6%. In the Gospels and Acts, it's nearly the same. It's 18.2. If you keep moving up to the next 8 most popular names, then the correspondence continues, where those 8 names make up 41.5% of names in the lexicon. And in the Gospels, it's nearly identical. It's 40.3%. So it's like 1% off. So he concludes that this is going to be impossible to explain as the result of invention outside of Jewish Palestine or too far off from the relevant time period. And it sounds kind of like eyewitness testimony would a lot. It'd be hard to explain even if you were in the relevant time period, getting the name ratios right. So I didn't know if you came across that study or what you thought of it.
No, but it sounds a bit to me like James Tabor's view of this Talpiot tomb. He's a little too quick to say that the occurrence of certain New Testament favorite names mean that this is the tomb of Jesus and so forth. To me, it's like a statistical thing. Like what the guy's name, I guess it doesn't matter. Was Jesus married? Walter Phipps argued that since most Jewish rabbis were married and Jesus is called a rabbi, he must have been married. I don't know if that even lends any plausibility. And in this case, it's hard to see how you could make the jump from narrative verisimilitude to historicity on the basis of something like that. It reminds me of the attempt to identify the ascribed authors of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, with New Testament characters of those names. Mark and Luke were the two most common male names in the Roman Empire. It's a little tough to narrow it down, and the others were pretty darn common also, and I just don't see, that seems to me to be a pretty big leap. It's not like we're saying the Gospels are written in the 10th century, when there would be no sense of what would have sounded right. I mean, did the occurrence and proportions or percentages of these names change drastically in the decades after the Gospels? Did they not exist in diaspora Judaism either? Yeah,
real quick.
I really need to know stuff like that, but it just seems to me.
They did. So, for instance, if you compared it to the names in Egypt, that correspondence just gets obliterated. And that was the whole force of the argument, is it really seems like, at the very least, it had to have been written at the relevant time and place. And
well, how do you explain how Mark, the fact that it's quoting, usually the New Testament is quoting the Greek Septuagint of the Old. Occasionally there are like Paul's own translations of the Hebrew, but on the whole, it's the Greek Septuagint. That seems odd to me. In the beginning of Mark 7, aside from the use of the Septuagint, there is this attempt to explain to readers these quaint customs of the Jews as if it's a TV travel log. He doesn't expect the reader to know what they need to about Jewish customs to make sense of the ensuing story. In John's gospel, there is the erroneous assumption that the high priesthood had a year-long tenure. I know F.F. Bruce's attempt to get out of that, but it just seems to me it's stretching the text. And it just seems to me that even the descriptions of farming and shepherding seem not to be familiar with Palestinian conditions. So I think there's at least a couple of sides to that.
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of what you're saying would need to be addressed as well, but that's not necessarily helping to explain the particular argument that was put forward. And real quick, and of course, we're not talking about what's relevant is the names that were used of the characters, you know, described as taking place in Palestine. So even if it's written somewhere else, the question is, if it was it written accurately? Well, you can look to see if the names match up with the right kinds of people and places at the time. So that seems more relevant. Go ahead.
Nicodemus, for instance, is very rare. It appeared among Hellenized Jews, but it's not that common. That doesn't mean there couldn't have been a Nicodemus in the Sanhedrin, but that sword cuts both ways. And it also reminds me of the argument of F.F. Bruce and others that the stories in Acts must be historical because Luke got the names of the local officials right, Asiarchs, Politarchs, etc. That strikes me as totally gratuitous. Just because a guy had some idea of the lay of the land politically in that period hardly means that he's right when he says that Paul was able to heal people with his used handkerchiefs. It's just a leap.
Right. So, I mean, I know Luke, he's supposedly accurately referenced 32 countries and 54 cities and 9 islands. And right, he gets all of these very specific titles right for people that you know, like a right, like the he rightly calls the magistrate a proconsul. But at a different time, that same individual would have been called an imperial legate or a proprietor. So he uses the right titles at the right times, and this wasn't available. Trites and Larkin write that, you know, Luke is given high marks even by skeptical critics for his factual fastidiousness when it comes to geographical, social, and political minutiae. And
he had to try to reconstruct this. Any way you cut it, these arrangements would have been recent history. I don't think that really implies that Paul was bitten by a viper and just shook it off, especially since there were many involved.
Right. Real quick, just to conclude the quote, they say it's anachronistic to take this accuracy simply as the result of the kind of research that a good historical novelist would do in the first century. Because here's why. They say in the first century, there were no reference works that would make such research possible.
Well, there was general knowledge.
I guess the implication, and I'm not an expert here, so that's why I'm asking you, but the implication, as I understand it, is that this isn't general knowledge, that you wouldn't know that, you know, off on this island over here, this is what the person would be called at this time, and at this city over here, this is what he would be called. That would be kind of hard to accumulate information.
Well, some guy in the street probably couldn't, but whoever Luke was, whenever he wrote, he obviously had classical education. He quotes Aratus and Epimenides, and he has Socrates sayings in there. We ought to obey God, not men. He appears to be familiar with the Bacchae of Euripides and so on. I don't think that, I mean, this is almost like saying, you know, Shakespeare couldn't have written all that stuff. He knows too much. Well, we can't just assume the ignorance of the ancients, especially somebody who was obviously a scholar.
You're right. And I'll conclude with this because I'm taking a bit of time. We never want to say, of course, that this proves anything. It's one of those situations where you're just taking beans and you're putting them in one evidence box or the other. And it seems like it could help contribute to the case. That this is grounded in eyewitness testimony, which assuming you grant that Luke and Acts have the same author, it would suggest that, you know, maybe he's not lying because he did claim that he was consulting eyewitnesses. That's all.
I'm not saying they're lying, right? It's not a question of lying, trying to pull the wool over somebody's eyes.
Well, in the case of talking about these stories that seem like they're historical in nature, if they didn't occur, I don't know how else I would categorize that.
Well, how about legends? There are plenty of those, and people aren't just necessarily sitting in the Saturday Night Live writers' room concocting them. I mean, is that where all the saints' legends came from, or the stories of the miracle-working rabbis? Did people just deceptively make them up?
Well, no, I think the author of Luke Acts is claiming, at least implicitly, to have a relevant eyewitness testimony for two reasons. One is because of the genre that's supposed to be put in. If it's Greco-Roman biography, as I understand it, the convention was that you were expected to be talking to the relevant eyewitnesses. And secondly, he claims to have been a travel companion of Paul. And so the implicit claim is that he got this information from a man who actually had been through all of this. And I'd love to talk about the sea voyage stuff as well, but I think that's some of the stuff that convinces me is that this is grounded in Paul's experience.
But the way Paul is described in his teaching, as Philip Wielhauer and others have pointed out, this doesn't sound like a guy that knew the Paul we know. He has him speaking the same way he has Peter and Stephen speaking, and he doesn't have the same idea of justification and so on. Plus, the we narratives, like you say, this I find Vernon Robbins pretty convincing that this is a vividness technique, much like the historical present in Mark, because in ancient sea voyage narratives, while you're on the high seas or in the harbor or whatever, it's we and I. It seems to me that is so likely that it renders the idea of the itinerary of an eyewitness plausible, but no more than that. It's as you say, though, of course, it's you put all the stuff in the blender and see what sense it makes. But I just don't find that compelling anymore. You could be right, certainly.
Yeah, I would check out, you know, Keener just put out a new really large commentary, that four-volume commentary on the Book of Acts. And that's where I'm getting some of this information. As I understand it, Roberts's study there is not that popular nowadays because he left out a lot of data. So there was one study that went into more of the narratives that he was evaluating. He said he left out this, and this. And in the cases that he looked at, like one by one, I forget who the author was that in another paper that responded to him, but that author said, well, no, that doesn't apply in this situation. And that one doesn't apply in this situation. And that's not relevant for this reason.
I have read that, and it struck me that it was the death by a thousand cuts. Mm-hmm. It's an old approach saying, well, the differences are greater than the similarities. And so what appears to be a trend in this direction really isn't. And I find that a failure to grasp what an ideal type is, that you don't have to have, like a miracle story is told with a drawing on the same set of narrative features. They don't all have to be in every one, but you can tell there's a general kind of structure that appears again and again. There are variations in order and so on. And at least, I mean, I haven't read the rejoinder in a long time, so I could be totally wrong, but I remember not thinking that it was that much of a torpedo to the hull. But again, I'm in no position to say, having with the memory I've got.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I'll go ahead and turn it over to others, and maybe we'll have
you are very well read, and I commend your research.
Thank you.
Thank you, Blake. Okay. We have three hands raised currently. Just before we move on to our next caller, let me just say something just make one or two thoughts out of off the back of what Blake just said. He talked about the frequency of names argument, which was something which was documented by Richard Balcom in his classic work on the subject, Jesus and the Eyewitnesses, the Gospels as Eyewitness Testimony, which I commend to people's reading. He really is a world-class scholar. One of the examples which he gave is where you have there's a remarkable correlation between the frequency of the name in first century Palestine and the use of a disambiguator, if you will, or a qualifier. So, for example, in Matthew 10, verses 2 through 4, we read the list of the 12 disciples, and it says Simon. Of course, Simon's the highest ranking name, and so he gets a qualifier called Peter to distinguish him from other Simons. And Andrew, his brother, and James, which is also a high ranking name, the son of Zebedee, got a qualifier, and John, his brother. Philip is a low ranking name, and so doesn't have a qualifier. Bartholomew, a low ranking name, doesn't have a qualifier. Thomas, low ranking name and qualifier, and Matthew, high ranking name. Qualified the tax collector, and so on. And this pattern is borne out in the Gospels. And so that suggests that the authors of the Gospels, whoever they were at very minimum conversant with the naming frequencies in first century Palestine. And that naming frequency differs depending on where you are. So the naming patterns in Egypt are very, very different from the naming patterns in Palestine. It seems unlikely that you would be... that your intuitions of the naming of the respective naming patterns in your time and place are likely to be reliable, particularly in the days before the documentation of such things. What would you say to that, Dr. Price?
Thing, there could be a historical basis for these being the names of Christian leaders, but how they've, like, there probably was a saint this and a saint that, but is everything we read about them historical? Nobody really thinks so. So that's a problem. But one of the examples is it compatible with Matthean authorship by an eyewitness that the character of Matthew in that gospel is an artificial conflation of two different Mark and characters, Levi the tax collector and Matthew the disciple, who are never said to be two names for the same guy, neither in Mark nor Matthew. Matthew the evangelist just takes the story of Mark the tax collector, changes the name to Matthew, and then in the list of the names of the disciples, whereas Mark just had Matthew, now we have in Matthew the evangelist, Matthew the tax collector. This seems to me very incompatible with Matthew the tax collector being the author of this gospel. There's a lot of things that doesn't solve. It makes it plausible, but I don't see how you can push beyond that. And as Theodore Whedon said about Bauckham's approach to, like, looking back at the forest and not just the individual trees, he says, if these things are simply transcriptions of eyewitness testimony, then you're just ignoring all of the work of redaction critics who have demonstrated certain patterns of changes in the Gospels. Is that all coincidence? And these people that go with, that try to apply the oral performance model of Parry and Lord, that these were just written down performances of the Gospels, they're just ignoring these patterns of redaction that imply these are creative, somewhat at least, fictional works. One guy felt free to alter the other one, just like the chronicler did with the Deuteronomic history. And it's a lot, even if it goes back in some measure to eyewitnesses, that doesn't really explain the Gospels we're reading.
Okay, concerning Matthew and Levi, is it not possible that Matthew and Levi were two names for the same individual?
It's possible, but why think so? It's another one of those things where, well, you know, if we tie it up this way and tape this up, it could be compatible with the traditional view, whereas I feel I have to look at it inductively and say it looks as if he's created a new character by combining these.
Ah, but we know that there were individuals who had multiple names.
Yeah, but you don't see him presented this way. I think of what F.C. Bauer said, anything is possible, but the historian wants to know what is probable.
Well, generally, when I'm doing historiography, I'd be inclined to give the author of the document I'm looking at the benefit of the doubt until there's good reason to think that they're in fact.
This is good reason. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff like this peppering the Gospels, leaving out, or Acts 2. Are you really prepared to say that a story of Peter walking on the water, oh yeah, that really happened, even though Mark and John seem to know nothing about it? The resurrection of Lazarus, that really happened, even though only John has it. And what do you know, there's a suspicious resemblance to a Lazarus character in one of Luke's parables. I mean, it seems to me, I realize it's different to different people, but to me, the literary, fictive approach makes a lot more sense of these odd questions than the insistence that it was all just taken down on the spot.
Right. I don't think the Gospels intend necessarily to be exhaustive. I mean, John even indicates to us at the end of the Gospel that he's not being exhaustive. So just simply because that one account doesn't have an...
Come on. Peter walked on water. And yeah, let's not bother mentioning it. Lazarus rose from the dead, and that directly fed into the desire to have Jesus killed. Yeah, let's not bother. And so many other things. Oh, there were really two demoniacs, but the other evangelist just picked out their favorite demoniac, the one with the longer, sharper horns. I mean, this whole sort of thing, it just seems outrageous unless... Or the... six or eight denials of Peter that Harold Lindzell pointed out, well, that would put everything in its place, but it winds up with this fanciful rewriting of the text.
Yeah, I just don't think I buy that methodology. I think, you know, having, if you have multiple accounts, multiple biographies of the same guy, I don't think you necessarily would expect all of them to have exactly the same stories.
You're dealing with something that makes sense in a mundane framework, but fantastic, spectacular miracles. Let's not bother mentioning it. It just seems impossible to me. It's like the traffic accident analogy. Well, the resurrection narratives differ over this. How many angels? How many halos? How many wings? It's just like a traffic accident. No, it's not.
Well, I mean, John 21:25 says Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world will not have room for the books that would be written. So he's even saying that Jesus has many other miraculous things, but
this is one of them, and it's grown in the telling.
Right. So I guess I just don't buy that. Or concerning Luke, and concerning the authors of the Gospels generally, I mean, Luke, Paul tells us in Colossians 4:14, for instance, that Luke was a physician. And we find Luke, when you read Luke Acts, we see Luke using terminology specific to the medical field, even terminology that is used in medical literature, such as in Hippocrates, for example, which is
decades ago. Henry Cadbury exploded this. It was in his dissertation, and somebody said it was too bad that in order for Cadbury to get his doctorate, he had to deprive Luke of his, because he looked exhaustively into all this Greco-Roman literature, and the incidence of medical terminology in Luke is no greater than it is in any other writer who was not, or many other writers who weren't supposed to be doctors. It's just like, hey, what's your diagnosis of this, pal? We don't, these technical terms have often become metaphors, and it's just been shown that Cadbury showed it, and you can still read the book, that he did not have a special medical terminology and knowledge that others didn't, that he must have been a doctor. That's a fantasy.
Okay, I would like to look into that, because I'm not familiar with that that source that you're citing. But as to also Luke, Paul tells us that Luke is the traveling companion of Paul, which is consistent with the we statements in the Book of Acts, which is...
Forgive me, I didn't quite hear the beginning of it.
Paul also identifies Luke as a traveling companion of himself, which is consistent with what you read in the Book of Acts. You've got the we statements in the latter end of the Book of Acts from chapter 16 onwards, and you have the eyewitness details in the Book of Acts that have been documented, which suggests, that the writer is an eyewitness.
What eyewitness features you're referring to? Peter healing people by his shadow? Take this seriously as eyewitnesses, like Oral Roberts' stories.
Well, we have numerous individuals and the correct titles assigned to them, and we have...
That's in no way an attestation of eyewitness origin.
Right, but there's numerous opportunities for him to err on that. And also we have, in the latter end of the Book of Acts, we have Paul, the author of Acts, even claiming to be a traveling companion with the Apostle Paul.
Is that the we statement?
Yeah, exactly. And then that's consistent with what Paul does.
That's debatable. You can hardly use that as a foundation stone for an argument when it itself is a matter of dispute.
Right, but we do have the author, the Apostle Paul himself, tell us that Luke was a traveling companion of him. So we...
You mean in Colossians or 1st or 2nd Timothy?
Correct.
There were a lot of guys named Luke, almost more than anything else. Mark's probably more common, but it's like, I just don't see how that is... that's just one of these things where it's like saying that the Gaius mentioned in 1 Corinthians must be the same one as in 3 John. Oh, there were loads of guys named Gaius. It's not the, doesn't really point in the direction. It's compatible with eyewitness origin, but it doesn't demand it in any way or even point to it particularly.
I mean, Colossians 4:14, 2 Timothy 4:11, and Philemon 1:24 are the references for Paul affirming that Luke was a traveling companion. And this is the same individual, Luke, to whom authorship of Luke is attributed by Tertullian of Carthage, Clement of Alexandria, and Irenaeus of Lyon as well. But
did they know? I mean, Irenaeus said that the elders of Asia accepted one particular textual reading in the Book of Revelation over the others. That sounds bogus to me. He said that the elders of Asia knew that Jesus had died in his 50s under Claudius. I don't think any of these people were in any better position to know. It was already too late. And Tertullian has John being boiled alive in oil and surviving it. I mean, is this, did this guy really know what he was talking about? Did any of them that late in the game? I doubt it.
Toby had his hand raised, so I brought him up. Toby, go ahead. Are you there, Toby? Okay, I got your Toby.
Somewhere. I probably bored him into a coma.
Yeah, I hope you can hear me. My connection is a bit bad.
Okay, go ahead, Toby. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, bad connection. Yeah, so I was just wondering, when you, because you've been studying this a lot, when you read about Jesus, what he said, what he did, his morals, his way of life, etc., as it is described in the Gospels, don't you find it the most kind of beautiful, captivating thing ever? Because that's how I came to know him, really. It was through that other people and so on, of course, spoke to me about him. But when I really started reading of him in the Gospels, that's what started turning me towards him as the way, the truth, and the life.
I do think Jesus comes across as pretty great, but I have to, and that got me into studying it as closely as I could, and eventually I began to realize a lot of this stuff is almost verbatim the same as a number of rabbinic, cynic, stoic, and other sayings at the time, and they're wise there too. And Jesus is depicted as pretty much an ideal figure, but then again, that makes you wonder how real he was. But let's assume that really was the kind of great person Jesus was. So was the Buddha, so were numerous people we know now. I'm glad to say so, but I don't think that somehow confirms stories of miracles and any particular account of how these sayings got to us. If there were eyewitnesses who passed down the material, great, but there were plenty of other people coming up with things that they thought Jesus must have said, as witnessed the Nag Hammadi texts and various apocryphal gospels. Nobody really thinks that Jesus said that. So how do you know? I mean, yeah, there might have been eyewitnesses that passed it on, but there's no way to tell who what came from whom anymore. We like the canonical result, but I have to admit it doesn't sound to me like the same Jesus in John versus the others even. I love them all, but that doesn't prove much as far as I can see. I mean, I'm a big Jesus fan. I agree with you. It's enticing, intriguing, winsome, all kinds of great wisdom to live your life by.
Yeah, I mean, you're a fan. I'm a follower.
Yeah.
But there's no other story other like the atonement, him actually dying for our sins. That he got me. He got me. I knew exactly where I stood. So that's what I'm talking about experiencing God through. Sometimes it's through reading. Sometimes it's through someone speaking to you or whatever. But you're convicted. Internally, it's, you know, it wasn't anyone else particularly that was saying to me, you're a sinner. I knew it. I knew because of what I read, and I knew also that he died for me. So it's that whole thing. There's no other story, if you want, from your perspective, that is that beautiful. But that's why I'm wondering if you really experienced him come into your life, so that you knew it was real. It was, you know, it was real, it was true. So it can be subjective, but then, I mean, anything you feel, you could call it subjective. I'm not sure if there are objective feelings, but
right.
What more than a feeling, and it's a witness within. You know you're a sinner, you know you need help, and you know you can do it. That's what I'm talking about, because that's what's affected people all across the world. So then you get away from the arguments and so on. So you read the words, they speak to you, you realize your state, and you turn to him. So
that just does not authenticate reports of ancient history. Forgive me, I don't mean this to sound facetious, but to me, claiming to know what happened in the past based on internal impressions is like Rudolf Steiner telling you about life in ancient Atlantis because he believes he can see the past in a visionary state. It must be compelling to him, but that just is not veridical necessarily. I mean, conceivably, it could be, but who the heck knows, because people are experiencing the same thing that assures them that Muhammad is the seal of the prophets, or that Gautama the Buddha was the one that told the truth. You just can't make that jump if you're pretending to do history. That's my call.
Okay, is that all from you, Toby?
Thank you.
Okay. Let me bring up Aaron. He had his hand raised. Go ahead, Aaron.
Hello, Jonathan. Thank you for doing this again, sir.
You're welcome. Go ahead.
I see that my Christmas is early because I see Santa Claus there.
Oh, hallelujah. Oh.
Sir, what an honor to speak with you.
Oh, and,
yeah, I got to pinch myself if this is real, you know, like talking to Santa Claus. I mean, is this real?
I was out in Milwaukee for a debate with Bart Ehrman, and the guys that put the thing on wanted me to be part of a skit they were filming, and so they got out a Santa Claus suit for me, and we went into a Chinese buffet to sort of mimic the end of the Ralphie Christmas Story movie where they go to Chinese restaurant at Christmas, and so we're sitting there just munching the teriyaki chicken and so on, purposely anticlimactic, and these two guys that looked like rappers were sitting at the next table, one of them with his girlfriend, one with his wife and his beautiful little daughter, and they came up and said, we gotta have our pictures taken with Santa Claus. So I was happy to have them do it, and so here I am in this red and white suit with my arm around the shoulder, this guy in his jogging suit and his bling and his sunglasses, say, what can I bring you, a little feller? It was just hilariously great.
And you have the voice too, huh?
Oh,
there you go. You got it, sir.
A friend of mine did this nasty, I shouldn't take time with this, but he did this fiendish prank phone call years ago. He was a pretty good Santa impersonator too, voice-wise. He called up this bratty little kid in the neighborhood and said, hello, Barry, this is Santa Claus. Just calling to let you know that you've been a bad little brat this year, so you're not getting anything for Christmas. So Christmas morning, don't go down and look under the tree because there'll be nothing there for you. Oh, fiendish, I tell you. Talk about being a sinner, that guy was. Sorry, go ahead.
Well, when you retire from this stuff right here, you can work as a Santa Claus, you know.
But, well, I thought about it. I always think about it too late in the day, though, because I can sure use the bucks.
Okay. Yes, sir. Like I've said, what an honor to speak with you, sir. And I have three main headings for you. Quickly, criteria of historical authenticity, the willpower to believe, and the historical method. And then finally, your debate with Dr. Bart Ehrman. Okay, so to begin with, the criteria of historical authenticity. Unfortunately, I don't have your colossal apostle, but I do have—
Yes, right.
I do have this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I also do have this right here.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah, first I ended up buying this one because of this. And in it, you were talking about the willpower to believe here. And this is really a very interesting book. It's about inerrancy. And on the back, there are a number of big names. A couple of them are Gary Habermas and Greg Boyd.
Great guys.
So anyway, before I get into the willpower to believe and the historical method, criteria of authenticity. Do you have a book, or is it in your somewhere in your website that talks about how you arrive at your conclusions? Do you use attestations such as embarrassment, wide attestation, things like that? Would you explain that, please?
Well, I get into that in The Incredible Shrinking Son of Man, and I think also in The Christ Myth Theory and Its Problems. And the multiple attestation thing, I think, fails because you can have multiply attested rumors. I mean, we see that happen every day. I remember back in the Long Island Lolita back in the 90s, this woman was the mistress of some guy who was a car mechanic, and she tried to kill the guy's wife. It's amazing I've forgotten it. It was such a big deal at the time. Well, all three of the broadcast networks did docudramas, or as I prefer to call them, schlockudramas, about this Amy somebody or other, and they were all very different as to who was doing what. This happened like a couple of months before, and you had these different gospels, and they disagreed. What the heck? I mean, if you can have multiple attestation of rumors, that means nothing to me. The dissimilarity thing sounds promising, but it isn't, because as John Warwick Montgomery once said, he wasn't trying to make the point I am, but he was addressing something Thomas Altizer said about how he was pointing to something in the Gospels he thought must be true because the early church didn't buy it, and yet there it is as a fossil in the Gospels. Well, Montgomery said, look, everything Jesus said upset or offended somebody in the early church. Ah, bingo, that's right. This whole argument assumes there was a single uniform early Christianity, whereas just reading the epistles, it's pretty obvious that wasn't true. They differ on all sorts of stuff, a different Jesus, another gospel, and so on and so on. So what offended one group of Christians didn't offend others, which we know because we know they were responding to opposite Christian opinions. So the fact that, would they have said that John baptized Jesus since it got him into such trouble? Well, there were people that didn't think that was a problem, that thought it was a credential that he had John's endorsement. And would anybody have said Jesus had to go for a baptism of repentance since they thought he was sinless? Not everybody thought that. If we didn't know it from other mentions of these heresies, the mere fact that it's been preserved, why do you call me good? Whoa, Excedrin headache coming up here for theology. The fact that Mark has that implies Mark did not find it offensive, because some later, like Matthew, found it troublesome and changed it, that Mark didn't. You can't assume they all thought the same thing. And so if one of them has a dissenting view, oops, it must be in there by accident. That's ridiculous. And to go further than that, all of this presupposes form criticism, the oral tradition, the oral transmission of Jesus' sayings and stories, because they were sermon illustrations, as Debelius said, or they were magical incantations and healing stories to be pronounced over the sick and all that. Whatever, unless they had some use, they were forgotten, which is why we know nothing of Jesus' personal appearance, for instance. Who cared? But this stuff we hear, we don't know what Jesus was doing before his baptism. Well, there's nothing to tell. It's no big deal. So we don't hear about it. Well, if everything was preserved because somebody found some use for it, and if something that was useful might just as well have been made up for its use, which I think there's several almost undeniable examples of that, well, then you've yanked the rug out from the whole tradition, because everything we've got must have been useful for something. If it was useful, it might have been made up for the purpose. Then everything is thrown into doubt. There's no way ever to know if anything was authentic, and I think we cannot. So that was one realization for me that just blew it out of the water. Maybe there was a Jesus who said some of these things, but if so, it's irrecoverable now.
All right, sir. The next heading I have here for you is the willpower to believe and the historical method. Now, in your book, Inerrant the Wind, you talk about two camps of apologetics, the presuppositional and the evidential. And you're suggesting that the presuppositionalists are honest with their presupposition. They come out and tell you, well, you know, they presuppose that this is all true, you know, and then they get into historical evidence. Whereas the evidentialists are not honest to tell you upfront. They actually already believe all these things, and then they look for something to support their belief. And so I was reading, you know, page 279 here. Yeah, I think it's page 270. So it is clear from a reading of much evidentialist literature that facts have been amassed to buttress beliefs already held on other grounds and by willpower. And so I ended up looking into this stuff, right, and ended up buying this. Unfortunately, it took Amazon a while to get to me, so I didn't get to read. And besides, it's got various, very tiny letters. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, it's terrible.
Yes, sir. I say all that. Well, I wouldn't say it's terrible. You know, the more stuff there, the better, you know, because your point being is historical, even if we establish them, even if we, in fact, historically speaking, have established that Jesus existed and he became alive somehow, but that's all provisional, you said, right? And provisional stuff cannot be dogmatically accepted.
Hmm.
And so you can't really, as a matter of faith in God, you know, mix that with the historical facts about Jesus being alive, becoming alive. You can't put the two together, because this stuff right here is subject to change.
Mm-hmm.
Would you expand more on that, please?
Yeah, I think that whether the Gospels are accurate, whether they represent the real Jesus, or even whether there was a Jesus, this has nothing to do with whether there's a God. There could be a God and no Jesus. There could have been a historical Jesus who didn't said a bunch of the stuff in the Gospels without there being a God, though he'd have been pretty surprised.
Or there could be both, right? Both God and the resurrection.
Yeah. It's just that they're two very different questions, and I doubt seriously that anybody really believes in God on other than intuitive grounds, and I respect that. It's a sort of a sense about the world that someone has and someone else does not have, but that I think does not work with historical. Like, imagine somebody saying, I believe that Napoleon really won the Battle of Waterloo because my heart tells me so. I mean, that sounds ridiculous, because it is, but I think it's the same thing here. Most people, including me, only started caring about Jesus because we did have this religious experience. But then once you start trying to buttress it with historical reasoning, then you're in big trouble. You're either going to wind up, I think, at least my experience was, being intellectually dishonest, that is kidding yourself. I don't mean deceiving anybody else, but wanting something to be true and so weighting the arguments. And this is what Van Til and the presuppositionalists did. They admitted, oh yeah, we're starting out with just embracing Christ, and once we do, everything falls into place, and the evidence has to be taken this way, not your way. But the person, evidentialist says that he also believes in Christ because of upbringing or conversion in virtually all cases, even when they say they didn't, like Josh McDowell. In a rare moment, he admitted in an interview that he converted to Christ because he wanted the kind of zip in his life that his people he knew in college had. And later on, he said, oh, I was... convinced of the stuff. He wasn't, so I never know whether to trust that stuff or not. But they were brought to it in for existential reasons, and then start trying to prove it. And naturally they're going to slant the thing. They don't realize it because they're really doing what Van Til says. They're embracing the Christ paradigm and then construing the evidence in the light of it. They just don't realize what they're doing ultimately. And the reason a lot of people come out of this, like I did, and Bart Ehrman did, and Dennis McDonald, and loads of the others, is that begin to realize, wait a minute, this is just looking good to me because it's what I want to believe. And if I just try to bracket it, as I did, I said, like, I like to use apologetics and evangelism, but I can't do that unless, if I put myself in their place, I would find what I'm saying, this argument for the resurrection, whatever, unless I would find it convincing. So let me suspend belief for the moment and say, would this really convince me? And the more you do that, the more you get into probabilistic reasoning. This is like Raymond Brown said, I believe it because the church says so, but I have to admit there's not that much evidence for the virgin birth, but there is for the resurrection. Whether he's right or not, that kind of weighing, that really destroys the initial faith commitment you had. Unless, like Brown or Van Til, you're admitting that your beliefs are determined by the dogma of a church. If you say, let me put that on the shelf and try to be as neutral as I can, goodbye faith. You're now believing or trying to believe what you think is merely probable. Eventually you're going to wind up on my team, I'm afraid. So I think the will to believe has no place in history. Like, I would rather believe the Nazi Holocaust didn't happen because I hate to think of such an unbelievable atrocity. But I know it did because my father was present in the liberation of Dachau. I don't even need to read further. I got immediate eyewitness testimony to that for sure. My dad saw it. Will to believe or not to believe has nothing to do with it one way or the other. You have to look at the evidence.
But, you know, sir, 2,000 years from now, if we're still around here, well, not you and I, but, you know, yeah. Humans, they can say what you're saying. Well, we can't really believe that the Holocaust happened because of, you know, we can't really rely on, you know, we can't be dogmatic about the Holocaust happening, you know, I mean, to be consistent, right?
You're right. That is right. I sometimes point that out. I'm glad you saw it too. Suppose the sources have been destroyed. Like, nobody's going to know what my father saw and wrote down and all that. And suppose the evidence became fragmentary because the libraries were all destroyed or something like that. You would no longer have to be a nut to deny the Holocaust. If there was ambiguous evidence and no historical memory of it, yeah, it would be a whole different matter then.
Well, how about this, sir? Going back to the resurrection of Jesus, how about this? We have the first century historical sources, external and external to the Bible. We have the church all throughout century, you know, be it Roman Catholic, Orthodox, you know, later on, you got all these denominations. It seems to me that since day one, the church has always believed that Jesus existed, that Jesus became alive, that he was the Messiah, and so on and so forth. There has been a consistency there. Now, to me, that's, I mean, you don't just, it's really, really, really highly probable that all that stuff happened. What do you say?
I think it's way too late. There's too much water under the bridge. It's just like when Martin Luther said he couldn't accept tradition as a basis for theology and practice anymore.
Well, it's a combination of tradition, history, you know, philosophy, and historical stuff. I mean, not just history, but all these things put together.
Well, I don't see how philosophy can fit into it. I mean, those are attempts to construe the universe and all that. I don't think
what I mean, sir, by philosophy is, you know, philosophy is history, philosophy of religion, philosophy, epistemology and things like that. Just philosophy.
And bear on it. I mean, historical epistemology is a matter of what you said before about what are the criteria you use, and feeling is not one of them. What one hopes or wants to have happened is not one of them. The teaching of an institution that depends on the alleged truth of these stories cannot be one of them. You have to go back as far as you can, and that's the Gospels. There's nothing really outside of them. There's barely anything in the Epistles. And once you look at, so it always comes back to the Gospels. Now, are there signs that these represent the party lines of certain ecclesiastical groups? Sure. Yeah. Are there signs that there were dissenting views, radically different views, Docetists, Gnostics, Ebionites, that we know were suppressed by Constantine and others? Yeah, there are other Gospels and so on. I don't think there is a unity all the way back. It's just that one of the factions won out, exactly as in Islam and Buddhism and all that. I mean, there still are factions, like you said, they've split again, Orthodox, Catholic, Protestant and all that. But I don't think that any of that really helps the analysis of the earliest sources, and they turn out to be rather dubious, in my opinion.
Okay, one more item on that, sir. This is just a matter of me trying to understand your point here. Can you be dogmatic with your assertion that you can't be dogmatic when it comes to this stuff? In other words, for you to assert that, namely, you can't be dogmatic with these things, right? Isn't that a dogmatic statement itself?
No.
If it is, then it's self-refuting.
Yeah, but I don't think it is. It's just a question of a rule of thumb. What seems to work? Like when these Hitler diaries came out back in the 80s, I think, there were people like Hugh Trevor Roper, big name historian, that said, okay, now we know something about their Führer we didn't before with these luckily rediscovered diaries. Well, then they made a fool of himself, because it wasn't long before somebody tracked down the forger and found out about the whole scheme. Well, he was dogmatic, and he shouldn't have been. If you open yourself to that when you jump to a conclusion too quickly, and then it's, or people that leaped on board this James Ossuary thing, like Ben Witherington and others.
Right.
It wasn't long before grave doubts were raised about that. I think it's just been refuted.
Dr. Price, how about temporarily being dogmatic? Would that work?
You know it's temporary, then you're not dogmatic. Like you can say, I always respected what Clark Pinnock, himself an evangelical apologist, said about Christianity per se as a view of the world and based on an experience and compatible with evidence. Look, I don't know this is true. If we did, we wouldn't be using the word faith. But he says this is a working hypothesis. Life works this way. He was properly humble in a Socratic way there. And that's what I'm saying, that if you can see how dogmatic historical assertions get blown out of the water again and again, so that just doesn't work. So it isn't really, I mean, maybe somebody could show how certainty is possible. That'd be great, but they haven't yet. I don't see how they could, but they certainly haven't so far.
Okay. All right, sir. Now, let's see. When it comes to being dogmatic, I mean, even I as a Christian, and I'm an aspiring apologist, I would say, too, that I could be wrong. Now, I'm dogmatic with my belief that God exists, the Christian God exists, the resurrection happened, all that stuff. I'm dogmatic. I really believe that with all my heart. But at the same time, I'm also thinking, well, since I'm not omniscient, I could be wrong.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I see things. And I don't think there is anything wrong with that. What do you think?
I don't think there is, though I'd be surprised if you almost have, it sounds like a double truth theory.
Okay.
Are you saying that you can't, if you're willing to say I might be wrong about the whole thing, you can't consistently say, and I know that no matter what turns up, maybe later still something that will turn up that will vindicate my beliefs. How can you know that? You're sort of admitting you can't. So there is a tentativeness about that. It's so far so good, you're sort of saying. Well, that does introduce an element of doubt that I'm surprised you could stand. But I admire the intellectual honesty you show.
Well, similar to your situation, I believe your assertion, when you assert it, you're actually dogmatic with that assertion. Namely, you can't be dogmatic, you know, with these things. You know, that's my take on that one.
Just experience as a method, it has poor results if you're dogmatic. You're choking off further research. You don't know what's going to come up. And like, as I understand it, all of these various historical Jesus scholars that have a galaxy of different views about Jesus. Right. Oh, he's a feminist. He was a community organizer. He's an apocalyptic prophet and all that. As I understand it, they all understand they're just pursuing different possibilities in research. Okay. They know it's tentative. And I admit there could be a Jesus. He could match up with the Christian theology, but as a matter of historical method, I mean, if there is any such thing, and we're not just going to say, I want to believe Alexander the Great was really the Son of God. I mean, you can believe whatever you want, but without historical method, there's no defense against any crazy view. You know, my uncle turned into a werewolf once. What? I mean, how do you expect me to understand that? I wasn't there. I don't know that he did or didn't, but why should I believe that? I mean, you always have to ask that. Are you going to believe any crazy thing anybody says?
All right, sir. The next one is your debate with Dr. Bart Ehrman. I actually had to pay $4.99 to be able to view it on YouTube. I understand why, you know, because it has to be funded and all that stuff. So now I got a couple of questions for you, Dr. Price. What would you say your strong points and your weak points, and what would you say you could have done better in your exchange with Dr. Ehrman?
Well, I wish I hadn't misjudged how much time I would have, because it was sort of an important thing that I barely got to mention, that the notion of the Son of God dying for sins and rising is not some innovation. It's part and parcel of the ancient sacred king mythology that Old Testament scholars agree is underlying a lot of the so-called messianic material in the Old Testament, that this was a well-known Jewish myth or piece of theology that need only have survived into early Christian times, and apparently it did. I mean, we know about Leviathan from the book of Revelation. He was part of that mythology too. So it wouldn't have been an unfamiliar notion. He said it was unprecedented. No one would ever have imagined that the Messiah underwent this. Oh, darned if they wouldn't. So I didn't get a chance to, my own fault. I thought I had more time. A really good point I made that he just never addressed was that much of his argument depends on having a definite starting point. We know Jesus was born around this time, he died around this time, and it was very shortly afterward that we have Paul saying this and the gospel saying that, and therefore Jesus existed. That is grossly circular. If Jesus was a product of the mythological imagination mutating over centuries, there isn't any starting point you can point to. It's like you're saying, if we assume there was a historical Jesus, then there wouldn't have been enough time for a mythical Jesus to come about. That's just self-contradictory. He just didn't seem to get that. Another thing I thought was important was he writes off the possibility that the various statements in the epistles that seem to assume a historical Jesus, like the, was it in chapter 10 or 11 of 1 Corinthians, about on the night he was betrayed and all that stuff, that mythicists say, well, these things weren't originally part of those texts. They were added later. And Bart says, well, that's just special pleading. If those things are genuine, then their goose is cooked. It couldn't be so. And I demonstrated that, no, all of those suggestions were made by scholars who never thought of mythicism. There are other appropriate reasons for are suspecting this, that they've been added. And it's just, it comes in handy for the mythicist case, but they didn't create it. He didn't say a thing about that. To me, that is a torpedo. And there were various other things. The Josephus deal. He does with Josephus in the famous Testimonium Flavianum passage. He does with that what he will not let people do with the epistles and say, we don't have any manuscript evidence for it, but the stuff that shows it couldn't have been written by Josephus, that must have been a later interpolation. It's just doing the same thing he accused the mythicists of doing. No action on that. So I would say the same thing. I just say a little less of it so I have more time left over for the sacred king thing. But I do have my case much more detailed in a chapter I've done of a book I'm working on called Bart Ehrman Interpreted, where I go into all the stuff at much greater length. By the way, I don't mean to sound combative, but I really got to know him a bit, and I think he's a great guy. He's a friend. I like him. It's just the sport of clashing on these ideas.
Right, right. Well, you know, there's also a YouTube that came out, I believe it was a week after. It was a discussion amongst a number of mythicists and one non-mythicist. It was Richard Carrier, David Fitzgerald, and Matt Dillahunty.
Dillahunty, yeah.
Yeah, Matt is not a mythicist. According to Matt, he is, I mean, he tried to be neutral at the beginning, and then after the debate, according to him in that YouTube video, he is convinced that Jesus existed. And but, you know, you can listen to the YouTube. Now, Richard Carrier made a comment, a number of comments, and he said...
going senile and so forth, and so...
A couple of things that stood up for me were, you didn't take notes, and you shouldn't have read your opening. What would you say about that, about those?
What the heck was my opening?
He said you read your opening statement rather than...
Yes, I did, yeah.
Because right away.
A pastor of mine once said in a sermon that he was quoting something he wrote because he didn't want to misrepresent his own views, which I always like. I had particular points that I wanted to phrase in a certain way, as I usually do in opening statements and debates, so I don't forget anything in the rush of it and all that. So I read it, and I would again. I don't know what the problem is with that. I mean, you might have thought what I said was bunk, but if so, I disagree with him.
No, he. To be fair, you know, he did say that, you know, somehow this particular debate setting is really hard, you know, even for you, as far as, because you both had opening statements and then question and answers, right?
That I didn't reply to Bart, but that ain't the case, because what Bart said was simply a kind of a Monarch Notes version of his book, Did Jesus Exist? And my statement was aimed at refuting points of Did Jesus Exist? So I did reply. I don't know what he was hearing, but maybe I
misunderstood.
No, he did say that, and I am confused.
He did say that?
Yeah, he said I didn't reply to him. I did indeed.
Okay. All right, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Comment about that, or
thank you, Aaron. Let me move on to someone else.
Appreciate it.
Okay. Blake wanted to draw attention to the local color that we can discern from the very cities as described in Paul's visit. He's talking about the book of Acts. So he says, consider Ephesus. The author of Acts accurately captures the Ephesians' current economic concerns for the temple of Artemis, as well as the Ephesians' unique way of saying God, the likely presence of silversmiths in the relevant area, their local concern for defending the Artemis cult, and the very real tendency for Ephesians to riot and drag people to the theater. And as you work through a lot of these contemporary commentaries, you'll see strong indicators of local color suggesting the author of Acts really did have his source in Paul or someone very much like Paul. What do you think, Dr. Price?
Well, the fatal problem with that is that archaeology does show that in Ephesians, many touristy kind of relics existed, silver replicas of the temple of Artemis, but not of the goddess. So that actually is proves just the opposite, that there's a major element of the story that the writer got wrong.
We have, let's see, we have 8 questions submitted. Let me just try and get through those. Liz Minnie wanted to ask, have you heard of the undesigned coincidences and what do you think of those?
Between the epistles and Acts?
And also the Gospels, yeah.
Well, with Acts, that all depends on whether you think that the author of Acts knew the Pauline epistles or not. And I don't really know what to think about that anymore. I had thought for a long time that he did not know them. But Richard Pervoe has made a pretty interesting case that he did. And I don't know what to think about that yet. But if he did, there's no problem explaining where he got the idea that Paul was lowered over the city ball out the window through a big basket, that Luke would have gotten it from 2 Corinthians. So I just don't know there what to think of it. But even if they're independent, it's not as if Luke necessarily made it all up. There certainly must have been legends about Paul circulating. I mean, we know there were. We still have plenty of them in the Acts of Paul and various other sources. So that doesn't really impress me a whole lot, especially since you can mount up against them, as Wielhauer pointed out, a number of places where it doesn't sound like the account of someone who knew what Paul thought. Like if you compare Romans 1-3 or 1-2 anyway, on natural theology, so-called, what the unenlightened, what the pagans knew about God, that they suppressed the truth. This doesn't exactly square with Acts 17, where he says that everybody was sincerely searching for God and so on. The justification thing, that through Christ you can be justified from matters that the law could not justify you on. That doesn't seem like somebody understands the justification teaching of Romans and Galatians. So I don't know what to think about that. It you can kind of come up with stuff on both sides. What are the ones between the Gospels and the Epistles? Do you mean like the places where, like in Romans 12, it sort of sounds like the Sermon on the Mount? Or
well, the Gospels interlock in undesigned ways. So just to give an example to illustrate, you have in Mark chapter 6, we have the feeding of the 5,000, which is also in John chapter 6. In Mark chapter 6, we read that there were people coming and going, and the people instructed to sit down in groups on the green grass. And so we have the color of the grass. And obviously in Judea, throughout most of the year, the grass is brown, except at a very narrow window of time because of the different levels of rainfall at the Passover season. Yet John's independent account, John chapter 6, tells us that the event took place at the time of Passover, which then explains why there are people coming and going, why the grass is green, and so on. And also John 6 tells us that Jesus turned to Philip to say, where should we send these people to buy bread? And we know John 1 and John 12 tells us that Philip was from Bethsaida, and then it's Luke's account, Luke chapter 9, tells us that the event of the feeding of the 5,000 is happening in Bethsaida. And so you have these interlocking details, and there's dozens of those that can be documented. So that's the gist of the argument.
That seems to me a pretty slim read. If we know that in would have been in Passover when the grass was green, chances are an ancient person with some knowledge of Judaism, Israel, the Bible would know it too. The Philip thing, I don't know. To me, that's very likely a coincidence, or the Philip was believed to be from there. So if the story was set there or near there, it would be a natural thing to assign to him. I just find that really.
The point is that there's a natural question that's raised by one account, which is answered incidentally by a different account. So, for instance, another example.
What's the question?
Yeah.
That is resolved.
Yeah, so I'll just take another example. In Matthew chapter 2, we read that Joseph was afraid to enter into Judea because he heard that Archelaus was reigning in place of his father Herod. And that's the only time in the whole Bible that we read of Archelaus. But we read in Flavius Josephus that around their time, Archelaus had, because of a riot among the Jews resulting in the death of some of his soldiers, he sent his entire army in a rage upon the Jewish temple at Passover and locked the doors and slaughtered 3,000 Jews, which then explains why Joseph was afraid of Archelaus at that time.
That is one way of explaining it, but it seems to me that there's a problem in the story in that the angel tells him the coast is clear, you can go back to Bethlehem, not to Jerusalem, but to Bethlehem. Yeah. And so he begins to do it, and he says, "Oop!" The angel says, "Gee, on second thought, maybe not. Go to Nazareth, because Archelaus is just as much of a stinker as his dad was." Well, why would he be? That seems to presuppose that Archelaus is carrying on the search for the infant Messiah to kill him. Like, why wouldn't Herod have thought his massacre of the innocents was effective? Why would he think Archelaus would be trying to get him? And if not, he's not going to Jerusalem anyway. Did he think there was a Hitler-like pogrom of all Jews in Judea? That's way too much of an explanation.
I don't think one would say that Archelaus was likely trying to track down the infants like Herod the Great was, but rather he was just a psychopath, and you know,
any Jew is likely to be killed by him. I mean, did all the Jews leave Jerusalem because of that? That seems to me far-fetched.
Right, but it explains why Joseph was afraid to enter into Judea when Archelaus was reigning there. But nobody else did either. The argument from undesigned coincidences really is a cumulative argument. So when you have dozens and dozens of examples of those which crisscross the documents. Between the Gospels and the extra biblical sources, and also between the Acts of Paul, the Acts of the Apostles and Paul's letters, as documented by William Paley, I think you have a very compelling cumulative case for the historical credibility of the Gospels and Acts.
You're not very demanding. All of that seems very fragmentary and just trivia, practically.
No, I think it's, as a cumulative argument, it's quite compelling. To take another example, in Mark 14:58 and Matthew 26:61, when Jesus is at his trial and false witnesses step forward and say, "We heard this man say, 'I will destroy this temple and in 3 days we'll build another, but not by human hands.'" Matthew and Mark both leave that unexplained. What is Jesus referring to? Well, whereas in the independent, the non-synoptic account in John, chapter 2, verses 18 and 19, when the Jews say, "What miraculous sign can you show us to prove your authority to do these things?" And he says, "I'll destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days," referring in the context to his body, and he's speaking about the resurrection. But John doesn't report the later misrepresentations and its use as an accusation. So you have this hand-in-glove fit, or that undesigned coincidence, if you will, which supports the authenticity of that saying.
Well, it might, but it's like multiple attestation of rumor, especially since the evangelists say he didn't say it. It was a false witness. So if they say that and John says he did say it, and Thomas says that, I think you don't have
notice in Matthew and Mark, the synoptic accounts, he doesn't say, "I will destroy this temple and raise it in 3 days." Rather, he says he's reported by the false witnesses as saying, I will destroy this man-made temple and 3 days will build another, but not by human hands." That's not what Jesus had said. So the false witnesses misrepresented Jesus. What he actually said was reported in John 2, where he's speaking about his resurrection from the dead.
That seems awfully like hair splitting to me.
Well, no, because Matthew and Mark both report him being misrepresented by the false witnesses, and they said they were falsely testifying about what Jesus had said. They were misrepresenting what he'd said. I think the argument from undesigned coincidences, I think, is quite a compelling argument.
Well, this is the kind of thing that just made me disillusioned with the whole endeavor. Different people do look at it differently. I could be wrong, but it just seems to me kind of a lame, a slim read to hang anything on.
Okay. Liz Mooney wants to ask about the resurrection. She says, "Without the resurrection, how do you explain the rapid growth of the early church?"
There are a bunch of ways. And if you look at the broad picture of the first couple of centuries, Rodney Stark, echoing E.R. Dodds and A.D. Nock, shows that the rate of expansion appears to have been no different from Mormons and Moonies in more recent history, that they were also controversial sects, but there were attractive things about them, and they did expand at pretty much the same rate. So no miracle is necessary. And in fact, again, from Nock and all three of them, this argument seems to me to slight Christianity. The most extreme case made for this is J.P. Holding in his book The Impossible Faith, where he basically says Christianity had no comeliness that anybody should desire it. It would have seemed absurd and repugnant to outsiders. Well, we happen to know that it didn't seem that way, and that outsiders were attracted to it for a number of reasons. The fact that they would minister to and rescue exposed babies and victims of earthquakes and all manner of disasters common in the day, and that they didn't care if you're Christian or not, they'd help you. They didn't practice infanticide of infant girls, so they had more Christian daughters to marry off, and they managed to convert their husbands. That the Pauline type of Christianity appealed to assimilating Jews and God-fearers who bought at becoming Jewish proselytes, but here was a thing that fit them better. And one thing after another, the courage of Christian martyrs and so on, that there were many genuinely positive and appealing aspects to the Christian faith. So it wasn't any surprise. And the idea of a slain and resurrected Savior, that was very common in the mystery religions. And so there were many attractive things about it. It shouldn't be a surprise that it did succeed rapidly. So I think it's the apologetic appeal ought to be to the excellence of early Christianity rather than it didn't take a miracle for it to expand. It deserved to expand, and we can easily see how.
Okay. Liz also asks, how can you suggest that the Gospels are full of legends when they are generally agreed to have been composed within the lifetime of eyewitnesses, i.e. far too short a time period for legends to develop, as this takes 200 or 300 years?
It's all circular, because we don't know who contributed these materials to the Gospels. We only say that they were eyewitnesses because of unreliable sources over a century later, like Papias, who would believe anything anybody told him, Lucy in the Charlie Brown cartoons. Judas, before he exploded, had grown to the proportions of a Thanksgiving Day parade float, and finally he was urinating maggots and finally blew up like the guy in Monty Python's Meaning of Life. To him, this is true. Oh, and Mark and Matthew wrote the Gospels. Like, this guy, there's no reason to believe anything he said, and Irenaeus was almost as bad. So it seems to me that it is utterly gratuitous to believe that this stuff comes from eyewitnesses. Some of it might have, but this notion that number one, that legends cannot grow and expand in quote short a time, even on a conservative dating, which I don't accept. Mark is like 40 years after Jesus. That's plenty of time. We can point to cases in more recent history where there's fuller documentation from characters like Yehuda the Seed to the Baal Shem Tov, to Sabbatai Zvi, to Charles Manson, where legends have grown fantastically overnight, practically. You can trace it in letters. You can see how the same story will grow over a very short period. But the notion that this could have been prevented, the fabrication of or the innocent misattribution of sayings to Jesus, the embellishment of stories, the reapplication of Old Testament stories to Jesus, that this would all have been choked off by this vigilant board of apostles fanning out over the early church to tell people, hey, cut that out. Jesus didn't say that. I was there. It's just a fantasy. It's a wish fulfillment of Apollos. apologists. There is no reason whatever to think that. And by contrast, there is this very tempting and possible analogy. I don't want to be circular, but it could have been like it was in the early Islamic community where they were making them up left and right for pious purposes. We don't know what happened, but you certainly can't say we know there was immediate eyewitness origin of all this stuff. That's simply a supposition.
All right, we have a hand raised from Garrett. Garrett, you're live. Go ahead. Hello, Garrett.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. Go ahead.
All right. Excellent. Hey, Dr. Price.
How are you?
What is up, man? Oh, my gosh. This is crazy. Man, you are the very second book I ever read getting into historical Jesus studies. And I love you, man. I love you.
Thank you. What was the first book?
Good question. Is Lee Strobel's The Case for Christ.
A terrible book.
So you can guess what the second one was, The Case Against the Case for Christ.
And by the way, I always like to point out, as I did in the book, I didn't want to call it The Case Against Christ because I'm no Jesus basher. It's just that the case this guy makes is worthless and does a disservice to his own position.
Yeah, right on. I wanted to ask you about, I've been starting to get into the authorship of the Gospel of John. And one thing that, is often said about the Gospel of John is that, that we know, or that Irenaeus stated that the Gospel of John was written by John and that he was a disciple of Polycarp, who supposedly was appointed bishop of, I forget where, but by Smyrna, thank you, Jonathan, by John. And so I just wanted to get what your take on that is. I know there's a lot to be said there.
Well, Irenaeus, again, I think, is spinning out hadith, so to speak, or isnads, the chains of attesters. Because if you look at what else he says in the same vein, anything he wants to push, he says it's the unanimous opinion of the Asian Minor elders, and it's obvious most of it can't be. He's nobody could verify it or not, so he's just saying, oh, yeah, you got to believe me, that's what they all think. I think this is another one of those things. There was confusion over whether Papias was a disciple of John and so forth. And it just seems to me there's no reason to think so. In fact, I tend to go along with David Trobisch's theory, which is just immensely fascinating, that Polycarp was the one who created the 27 book version of the New Testament and the Christian ordered Septuagint that the churches signed on to, though it took a while, another couple of hundred years for Athanasius to give it the imprimatur. But even then, people were using other stuff. Anyway, Trobisch makes a very compelling case, which of course doesn't mean it's true, right? That's all you can say is, whether it seems to be a strong reading of the evidence or not, that it was Polycarp who chose these books and came up with the names, because as any conservative or liberal New Testament introduction will agree, the four evangelist names are not integral to the documents, unlike Paul in the epistles. I mean, whether he wrote them or not, it says that he did, but the gospels are technically anonymous. And that to call them kata, Mark, and so on, according to Mark, implies you now have a bunch and you've got to differentiate them. Whereas if your church had the gospel, let's have a reading from the gospel, you wouldn't have needed to say who it was by. How did he know who the elder was in the three epistles in the New Testament? How did he know that it was John, the beloved disciple, or whoever tagged him with that name? Well, because it's an anti-Marcionite stratagem. The Marcionite New Testament, the first New Testament canon, of course, was simply an earlier version of Luke and a collection of the Pauline epistles, or so they credited them. And so to counteract that, to co-opt the Marcionite New Testament, Polycarp or somebody, I mean, we know Polycarp was an opponent of Marcion, they decided, okay, we're going to use their scripture. But of course, it's kind of heretical, so we're going to pad out his gospel, making it into canonical Luke. We're going to get Mark, Matthew, and John, though they're going to take some doctoring too, and there's Bultmann's Ecclesiastical Redactor and so on involved. And we need to counteract the notion that Paul was the only legit apostle, so let's put together the book of Acts that will show how Peter is every bit as good an apostle, and the others too, though they have little to say about them. But there are all these epistles with Paul's name on them. Let's see what we can scrape up by others. Well, here's a couple of Peter ones. Here's three that I guess might have been by John. What the heck? He's a prominent name. So, and the same thing with James. Who is James even supposed to be? James the Just, James son of Zebedee, whatever. And it's not clear. And so and Revelation, of course, that was a huge problem. The whole idea of putting them, attributing to them these New Testament bigwigs, looks like another kind of it's not thing. Let's lend them authority by putting these names on them, or by finding materials that have already used the names, experience, like the Petrine epistles. And so if that's the case, it does make the New Testament table of contents a lot earlier than some had thought. But it implies that it was all a kind of a literary editorial work. And to take Polycarp out of that and say the historical Polycarp was a disciple of this character, John, it's like saying that Mark Twain was a friend of Huckleberry Finn.
And I know that, and I'm an atheist, and I've really enjoyed reading your work over the years, and I actually have my copy of The Case of Christ is kind of weird. It's actually signed by Bart Ehrman, because I went to go listen to a debate between him and Dan Wallace, and I didn't have anything from him to sign, so I was like, well, I'll take The Case of Christ. So
false description of authorship.
He was like, you know, I didn't write this, right? And I was like, yeah, I know, but I'll get Dan Wallace to sign it too. It'll be great.
Somebody brought me someone else's book too, because they didn't have one of mine to sign. So rather than look like I was claiming credit, I said, I did like a blurb and said, this is a great book. I know you're going to enjoy it. Then I put my name. I had a friend who had all manner of books in his study, and a friend of his who was mischievous would come over and, while he was there, grab a book and do a false autograph on it, like to Mike, best wishes, Brigham Young.
Hey, to get a little bit more feedback on this whole Polycarp thing, I know that there's a different tradition too about who appointed who to the bishopship of what. So do you know a little bit about that?
Not in that particular case, though there are other things like with Ignatius that show that you, well, there are different accounts of the martyrdom of Polycarp that make you kind of wonder what they really knew about the guy. But with Ignatius, the notion presupposed, actually the notion that occasions the seven epistles of Polycarp it's predicated on this idea that he was arrested in Antioch and brought to Rome to be thrown to the lions. It's hard to see why they would do that. And there is a surviving tradition alongside it that no, they killed him in Antioch. It's a little hard to imagine that where that would have come from had he actually died in Rome. And you begin to wonder if that story was concocted in order to explain how the letters actually radiated out from Rome, written as a pseudepigraph to get back to where they supposedly started. And there's real reason to believe, as John Calvin did, that none of the Ignatian epistles are authentic. And there's big problems with all of that stuff. Like First Clement, written by the Bishop of Rome. There's no name on it. It doesn't even claim to be by Clement. It's amazing what people will take for granted and start using as great sources for early Christianity. Often they're just kidding themselves.
Irenaeus does tell us that Clement is the author of an epistle to the Corinthian church. He described some of the contents which match that of First Clement.
Though that's good, but it strikes me like who knows who the author was. He may just be nominating this character. There are loads of Clementine pseudepigrapha out there. The two epistles of Clement on virginity, the pseudo-Clementine recognitions, the Clementine homilies, Second Clement, and others still, I think. It's just impossible to tell. It could be. But there's no way to know how he knew what he knew if he knew it.
Right. I mean, the letter is definitely addressed to the Corinthians because he speaks about the previous letter that Paul had written to them.
Well, that just shows somebody had read 1 Corinthians and was trying to invoke its authority. I don't know that that would have to mean.
But I am not quite sure what motivation some forger would have because he doesn't really introduce any new doctrine that's not consistent with the New Testament.
No, I'm not saying it was a forger. I'm saying it's anonymous. And so it's very difficult to say who was in a position to know, for instance, what happened to Peter and Paul when they bore witness and all that stuff. It seems to me to have affinities with the second and third century apocryphal Acts where apostles are killed out of jealousy and so on. So it's just not forgery. It's just anonymous. We don't know who the heck wrote it because the text doesn't even say.
Okay, let me just, because we're getting late and we should probably wind up soon, let me just ask one more question that's been submitted. As Simeon Denk says, if you examine the gospel, I want to say this one before because this is a good one to end on. If you say, this is from an anonymous viewer, says, if you say multiple attestations doesn't do it for you, makes you sound like a hyper-skeptic, what criteria would you accept to believe something is true but the Gospels fail on? Right?
What would I accept as evidence of authenticity?
So you're saying what criteria would you accept to believe that something is true but the Gospels fail on that criterion?
Oh, boy. It seems to me you would really have to have some darn good reason to believe stories in which a guy walks on water and ascends into heaven and changes water into wine and miraculously multiplies food. The prima facie, it just seems like extraordinary claims need extraordinary evidence. So, I mean, I don't know what could count if you had yet more collections of miracle stories and sayings that sound similar to the Mishnah and all that. The same thing would arise about them. I do say with regard to mythicism, if someone were to find some papyrus letter that could be dated plausibly to the first third of the first century, in which somebody writes home and says, "Oh, I chanced to be in Galilee and heard the famous Jesus speak, and he's in truth a wise prophet." To me, that would destroy mythicism, the idea that there wasn't a historical Jesus, and maybe it'll happen. But it's difficult to see how you could confirm collections of wild miracle stories with more of the same. So there's too much water under the bridge. Like Martin Luther said, the Catholic tradition may preserve authentic teaching of the apostles, but the stream is so polluted there's just no way to know anymore.
Okay, well, thanks for joining us tonight, Dr. Price. It's been great to have you on.
Oh, what a joy. I really appreciate it very much. You certainly got a lot of astute and intelligent listeners. I commend them.
Well, thank you, and we should have you on again sometime.
Sure, yeah. This is really great. What an honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Price. Take care. Mm-hmm. Right.